Community, how are we doing this morning? Good. So we asked Vanessa Workman to come and share a little bit. She said she felt like God had put something on her heart. We didn't talk about that because she is a prophetic voice and has spoken into our lives before, and so there's massive trust there. And so what she didn't know is that what you shared is what's in the message this morning, and so that's only God. So thank you for joining us this morning in person or online if you're there. Wherever you are today, it's an honor to be with you. It's an honor because we're together, right? The Bible says, do not forsake the gathering of the brethren as some are in the habit of doing, but all the more as you see the day of the Lord approaching. And that day is closer now than when we first believed, amen, right? Like, it's in the gathering that we find community, and in the community of believers that we find strength. Because not all gatherings, there's strength, right? Companionship of fools suffers much harm, right? Like, stupid rubs off. But when we are together with believers, we find strength. I love our church. Last week, we launched our 8-week series and study through the book of Colossians and found that the church in Colossae was a beautiful and faithful church, one that was known for loving God and loving others. They were a strong community of believers who were known for living out the Great Commandment and for chasing after the Great Commission. They were known for it. In chapter 1, the first half, last week, we saw that. They love, they're faith-filled, and it's this thriving community. But also remember that this was written during a time where there are still eyewitnesses living who actually saw Jesus resurrected. Okay? This wasn't 100 years later. It was during a time where people would be sitting around telling the story about how they saw Jesus, who was dead, alive, and speaking to his people. So they know Jesus. But Paul still writes because something that came up that the Apostle Paul heard about that was a threat to the church. It was an anti-Jesus message that had come in and infiltrated the people of the church in Colossae. And here's the thing. It's the same threat we face today as the people of God. Just because we can be known for our love, just because we can be known for how we care for others, does not mean we can't be infiltrated and our faith threatened by a false message of Jesus plus something else. We have to know Christ and him fully in order to be solid in the faith. We'll see that this morning. So this isn't just a history lesson, but a warning to all believers throughout all of time to beware and stand ready. To beware and stand ready. Because the enemy, he's prowling around like a roaring lion, looking for those he can devour. Those who are willing to water down and dilute their pure faith. That's why this letter was written. To combat the message that Jesus was a good start, but more had to be added. Jesus was a good prophet, but he was equal to other angels and deities. You see, it was a message cloaked in deep spiritual understanding that was only known to a few. Don't you know? Don't you know that I've heard? It sounded mysterious. It sounded spiritual. And it sounded close to what they had already understood. And so the people of Colossae began to give it room in their hearts and minds, and people were falling away from the pure faith that they had in Jesus because of it. The same exact tactic of the enemy is being used on us today. Want to know a secret? A deep spiritual thing? Come close and listen. That's why we have the book of Colossians, to look at what's going on around us and compare it to the Word of God and see if it lines up. Do these so-called secret, deep spiritual truths, these things, speak of Jesus and him resurrected? Do they talk about his ultimate authority and supremacy? If you don't know Christ and his word, which is what you were talking about this morning, if you don't know Christ and his word, then you're in a vulnerable position where someone or something can come in and threaten the validity of the faith.
Yeah.
So much so that the Bible says in the last days, there will come many false prophets who will lead many away. This isn't about non-Christians, it's about us all. So Paul wrote to the letter to the Colossians to proclaim the supreme power authority and sufficiency of Jesus. He is enough, right? While Paul was in prison, he heard the report about this false teaching in the city of Colossae. So Paul responds by affirming that nothing needs to be added to the work of Christ. As Lord of all creation, he is more than enough for every believer in every culture and throughout all of time. This isn't about some secret knowledge or secret prophecy only revealed to a select few, but bringing us back to Scripture, which is where the enemy wants to keep us from. The enemy wants to keep us from Scripture, coming back to Scriptures, back to the truth, back to the Word of God. Check this out. It's the Word of God that is filled with the power of God, which pours out the knowledge of God about the person of God for the glory of God for the people of God, right? It's in His Word and in Jesus that we find real power to transform our lives. And as we'll see, Jesus is the start, the end, and the in-between for everything. That in Him, we have everything we need in order to live, in order to grow, and in order to thrive. We have everything we need to live on mission and to accomplish every good thing He has set up in advance for us to do. It's in Him alone. This morning, we're going to be in Colossians chapter 1, starting in verse 15. If you have your Bibles, you can open up to that section now. If you don't, that's okay, because the verses will be on the screen for you. But here's what I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to take notes today. It's important to know Christ and Him fully. Nothing more and nothing less. That way you can defeat the enemy when he steps in with another message than this. Okay? So we can pray with me as we dive in this morning. Lord Jesus, we recognize that You are supreme. That You are over all. That You are in all. And so in all that we do, in all that we say, in all that we are, we give You the glory this morning, God. Because You are worthy of all honor and praise. You are worthy of all worship. And so we surrender our lives to You, like the song said, we surrender. We surrender to You today. Would You speak to us from Your Word? Open our ears that we may hear. Open our minds that we would understand. And open our hearts that we would accept all that You have for us this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. In Jesus, we have everything we need. Amen. In Him, we find our true self. In Jesus, we find direction for our lives. In Him, we find strength to get through any battle. And in Him, we have a faith and a trust, knowing that everything will be okay, no matter what comes. Let's jump into Colossians 1, verse 15. It says, "The Son, Jesus, is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For in Him," we're going to see that a lot this morning, "for in Him," in Jesus, "all things were created." Say, all things.
All things.
All things were created. Things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible. Listen to this. Even thrones, powers, rulers, authorities, all things have been created through Him and for Him. In Him, we can rest. In Him, we can rest knowing that He has a plan. Jesus is the manifestation of the actual image of the invisible God. He has been revealed. It's not a secret or an unknown anymore. He was the firstborn over all creation, for in Him, all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, thrones and powers or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through Him and for Him. This is great news, you guys. This is great news for us because this answers two of life's most asked questions. This solves the age-old existential crisis of who am I and what am I supposed to do? Like, who am I? Who am I? And what am I supposed to do? Anybody have that question ever? I still have it. I talk to high school students going into college, and they're like, I don't know who I am, and I don't know what I'm supposed to do. It's right here. Check this out. This answers the question for you, all right? All things were created through Him and for Him. You are one of those things. A creation of Jesus to be used for Jesus. You are a creation of Jesus to be used for Jesus. He is over all creation and has a plan for all of creation. Big picture stuff, all the way down to you. You are uniquely created and made through God so that you can be used by Him. Yeah. That means He has a plan for you. He has a plan for the thrones of this earth and in the heavens. He has a plan for those in power. Hallelujah. He has a plan for our rulers. He has a plan for those in authority. Everything we see happening in the world around us is in the hands of Jesus. That's comforting, isn't it? Like, He's over it all and has a plan for it all. So should we freak out seeing all these things unfolding around us politically and culturally? No. In Him, all things have been created. Through Him and for Him, in Him, we can rest in the faith, knowing that He is over it all. Amen, all by myself. That means when something doesn't make sense to us, we can rest in the fact that it makes sense to God. When someone is taken from us too soon in our eyes, we can rest knowing that He knows. When the world around us is being shaken and turned upside down like we see happening in our world today, we can rest knowing that He has a plan. And when we feel all alone and useless, we can rest knowing we've been created by Him and for His great purposes. Verse 17. It says, He is before all things, and in Him all things hold together. And He, Jesus, is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything He might have the what? The supremacy. Say it again. The supremacy. In Him all things hold together. Let's say that together. In Him all things hold together. Jesus is the head of the body, which is the church. Who's the head pastor? Not me. Jesus. He is. Who has the supremacy? Not me. Jesus, right? Not us. Jesus. Who was the firstborn from among the dead? Jesus. Guys, He is the story. He is our everything. If He's into the minute detail of our lives and He's the head of the church, let me ask you a question. Don't you think He'll care for us in every way? If He's our great shepherd, don't you think He'll guide us in every way? I can assure you He hears the cries of His people. He sees the injustice and the prejudice. He knows the hearts and minds of all people. He sees it all, and in it all, in Him, we have a faithful, listen, never waning, listen, never burnt out high priest who cares for us in every way. Pastors and churches, they get it wrong. People have gotten it wrong, right? People get it wrong all the time because, you know, hurt people what? Hurt people, right? Jesus is not that person. That's not Jesus. When we feel like we're alone, baby Bowie is beautiful. He is beautiful. Look at that. Oh, man. Gosh, I love her. She doesn't feel bad. She is beautiful. All right. Pastors and churches have hurt people. They get it wrong because they're human and they're flawed, but Jesus is not. When we feel like we're alone, when we feel like we can't move on, Jesus is here. He is working, and He is good. In everything, He gets the supremacy. He is before all things, and in Him, all things hold together. So what does that mean? How many of you guys know Pastor Louis Giglio? Anybody? Okay, I'm going to go there. If you know, you know. If you know, you know, right? So Pastor Louis was doing a passion tour, one of his big outreach events for young adults. And after one of the last nights, this microbiologist comes up to Pastor Louis and he starts talking. He's like, hey, so where are you going? What are you doing next? And Pastor Louis's like, well, I'm going to go back to my church and I'm actually teaching on the book of Colossians. And the microbiologist is like, really? That's incredible. What do you know about cell adhesion molecules? And Louis's like, a what? You know, they're like, what? The biologist said, do you know when you teach Colossians 1:17 that you have a knockout punch for the illustration? He's like, okay. It's a cell adhesion molecule, Pastor Louis. What is that? I don't even know. Like, so then he gets down on Pastor Louis' level. He's like, a cell adhesion molecule is the glue that holds all cells together. It's what keeps your skin on. It's what keeps your organs together. It's the bonding agent for all of the cells in your body and in life. It's a cell adhesion molecule called laminin, L-A-M-I-N-I-N. So he tells Louis, hey, you should go Google it. So Louis does. And what does he find? It's incredible. Look at this first picture. This is a picture of laminin.
Wow.
That's an actual cell diagram of laminin. Somebody didn't doctor it. They didn't cut off the bottom or the sides. That's a picture of laminin. And then this is what it looks like in the body. Show them the next one. That's an actual laminin cell found in the body. He, Jesus, is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Did you know that before all of creation, Jesus was? Did you know that in him all things hold together? Is it an accident or some freak chance that we are held together by the inside with a cross? For in him all things were created. Things in heaven and on earth, visible and what?
Invisible.
The invisible things created on purpose through him and for him. If he is in that level of detail, don't you think he knows what's going on behind closed doors in Washington as well? If Jesus had that level of detail, don't you think he knows each and every part of your story and what you're walking through right now? You see, he sees and he knows. Guys, we have a faithful God who's holding us together. He loves us and cares for us. How? In every way. He holds us together. We aren't alone. His handiwork is evident in us, even down to a molecular level. The Bible says he knows the number of hairs on our heads. For some, it's easier to count than others. But he knows. That's pretty funny. My father-in-law.
What?
Yeah. I heard you in my heart. God knows how many or how little we have on our heads. We make it a regular practice in our home to pray and to thank God for all the things that he does, seen and unseen. We literally pray, thank you, God, for holding back the things we don't even know. Thank you, God, for doing things we don't even see. Thank you, God, for forgiving us for sins we don't even know about. We pray that regularly over our kids, and I encourage you to do the same. Because we know that he's working things out for us, even when we can't see it. Verse 19, Colossians 1. It says, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, in Jesus, we see it again, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. How many of you feel that you're free from accusation this morning? That's the enemy's voice if you're not. That's the enemy's voice if you're not. Oh, I'm accused, and I don't stand holy. I don't stand blameless or spotless before God. That's the enemy. Because look at what Jesus says about you. Those who are in Christ, in him, we are reconciled. How does God care for us? He takes our ragged and beat up, beat down lives, and he makes us whole. God was pleased to have all his fullness. Think about that statement. He's a star-breathing God. Did you know that? It says he created the heavens and the earth and the starry host with the breath of his mouth. He's a star-breathing God. He says he was pleased to make all his fullness, all the fullness of God, dwell in Jesus and through Jesus so that he might reconcile to himself all things. What does reconcile mean? It means at one time we were separated from God because of our sin. Sin broke off relationship with God. In the beginning, when Adam and Eve sinned, they were cast away and out of the Garden of Eden. They had perfect relationship with God, but because of sin, that relationship was torn and broken. It was separated. However, God saw fit that in all his fullness, that includes his compassion, his care, his grace, his love, his forgiveness, all the fullness of God dwelling in Jesus and through Jesus, so that he might reconcile to himself all things. Reconcile is to restore relationship and harmony. We have friendship and relationship restored with God because of Jesus, who is God. Jesus, the perfect, spotless Lamb of God, was sent to this earth to live a perfect and holy life, one we could never live, so that he could sacrifice himself on the cross as our perfect atonement, our covering for sin. He made peace with us through his blood shed on the cross for our sins. You can't sit here and say that God doesn't care for you. You can't sit here and say that God would never forgive you. You can't sit here and say that you're too far gone, because it's a slap in the face of our perfect Savior. Where in here, show me, where in the Bible does it say all things have been created through him and for him except you? Or where can you find where it says God was pleased to have all his fullness rest in Jesus to reconcile, to bring back together in perfect harmony all things except you? You can't find it, because it's not in there. In fact, it says the opposite is true. Once you were alienated from God, and you were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has what? Reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. When it comes to our justification, our legal standing before God, our own good works are in no way the grounds of God's declaration that we are righteous. It's not anything that we've done. Indeed, the gospel is good news, because we are saved not by what we have done, but by what Christ has done. We are accepted by God, not because of our works, but in spite of them. Yeah. He says, through Jesus and for Jesus, we have been restored in relationship and made holy. Without blemish and free from accusation. You see, the enemy calls us by our sins. Jesus calls us sons and daughters by his name. How do you view yourself this morning? In light of that declaration, where is your standing? Do you believe in Jesus? Here's what he says about you if you do. You are reconciled. You are restored. You are holy. You are spotless. You are blameless, not in what we have done. It's all supremacy to King Jesus. But here's the catch. We have to continue in that knowledge. It says, if you continue, verse 23. If you continue in your faith, established and firmed, and do not move from the hope held out in the gospel, this is the gospel that you heard and that was been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. In him, we have faith. If you continue in your faith, you see, apart from Christ, we have no hope. The Christian life is not hard, it's impossible. You cannot live it on your own strength. Only by the power of Christ can it be done. You might be sitting here thinking, well, I've put on a pretty good show for a long time. Not forever. And not before God, you haven't. You see, to live this life without Christ is impossible. When the road gets hard, when we face uncertainty and chaos, Paul said, keep going. We have the promises of God that we are reconciled and restored, holy, spotless, blameless, if we continue in the faith established and firm, not moving from the hope held out in the gospel. I said earlier that there was a critical threat to the church in Colossae. What was it? It was Gnosticism, a false belief and understanding of Jesus. Paul was saying, forget all that. Hold to the faith in Jesus. Be well established in his word. Hold firm to it. Do not move from it. Know it. Believe it. Follow him. This is who Jesus is. He is in you. Down even to the molecular level, he is in all and is before all. He has created you to use you. Don't forget the hope, the truth, and the faith. Paul was saying, keep the faith. The problem with Colossae, like the problem with the church today, is the draw to unspiritual things. There's a draw to unspiritual things. People saying, hey, I know a deep secret, a deep truth, a spiritual truth revealed only to me. Secrets and mysteries that draw Christians out of the safety net of the scriptures and down a path of so-called enlightenment. The only true enlightenment comes from Jesus and his word. The only true enlightenment comes from Jesus and his word. In the book of 1 John, it says, in the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. Jesus and his word are one. They are one and the same. It's his voice. Who is above it all? Jesus. Who's in control of it all? Jesus. So continue in your faith, established and firm. Don't move to the left or to the right with some other promise outside of Scripture. Everything that needs to be revealed has been revealed right here in the Bible. In him, in his word, we have strength. We have to hold firm to the gospel, which we have heard and has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. It's not Jesus plus something. Have you heard the new revelation? Have you seen the new way? Jesus actually talks about this. He says, if someone says, here is Jesus, or there he is in the wilderness, do not go out. Or if someone says, here is Jesus in an inner room, do not believe it. It's an end time fulfillment of prophecy. He says, continue in the faith established and firm. The faith of the gospel, which we know from his word. Verse 24. I promise we're almost there. It says, now I rejoice in what I am suffering for you, and I fill up in my flesh what is still lacking in regards to Christ's affliction. For the sake of his body, which is the church, I, Paul, have become its servant by the commission God gave me to present you the word of God in its fullness. So Paul, asserting Jesus as the head and himself as the servant. Then he says this in verse 26. The mystery that has been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the Lord's people. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He's revealed it. In him we have the hope of glory. Not Jesus and me, it's Jesus in me. The mystery that has been kept hidden is now disclosed to the Lord's people. To them God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles, which is us, those outside of the Jewish faith, the glorious riches of this mystery. What mystery? What is revealed? Christ in you, the hope of glory. It isn't Jesus and me, it is Jesus in me. The things that need to be revealed have been revealed. Jesus in me is the hope of glory. Jesus in me is the security in heaven. We don't get there and say, look at all the things that I've accomplished. We don't say, look at what I've done. It was Jesus and me. Jesus is my friend. I have a friend. Jesus is my friend. He's my buddy. He's my homie. We don't get to heaven and say, look, it was Jesus and me. Jesus talked about this in Matthew 7. He says this, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me on that day, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? And I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, you evildoer. It's terrifying. It's not about us. It's about what we have. It's not about what we have done. When I die, let my name die with me. It's not me, but Christ in me.
Yeah.
That's the hope of glory. It's for his glory, his honor, and his name. We don't get there and say, look at what I've done. He says, I'm going to burn that up. I'm going to burn that up with the flame of judgment. If we show up and we say, Jesus in me, well done, good and faithful servant. I knew you because I was in you, and you in me, and me in you. We were one in the Father. I knew you. Welcome, right? Well done. That's why it's so important to know Christ and to know his word. If we don't know it, if we aren't firmly planted and rooted in it, then we can be tossed around like a sailboat in a hurricane. Verse 28. He is the one we proclaim, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone fully mature in Christ. To this end, I strenuously contend with all the energy Christ so powerfully works in me. In him, we have everything. It's Jesus in me, all Jesus, all the time. He's the one we proclaim. Who proclaims? The faithful and the true, the body of Christ. We proclaim Jesus, encouraging and teaching anyone and everyone with what? It says all wisdom. Did you get that? All believers, all wisdom. You see, he's revealed it to us. He's revealed it to us, his people. Why does the enemy hate us so much? Because he knows we know. He knows we know. Oh, shoot. They know. They know about my schemes. They know about my ways. We've got to take these guys out. Why do they try to take the Jews out? Because then it's like, well, I can cancel out the promises of God if I can take the Jews out. He knows. We know. All wisdom, all believers, know the word and preach the word. It's our commission. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? If you've been here at all the last 15 weeks, you're like, Mike, you're beating the same drum. You're right. Great commandment. Great commission. Great commandment. Great commission. Why? Because that's what Jesus has called us to. The mystery has been revealed that the indwelling of the Messiah and the hope of the glory of God to all who trust in him and hold true to his word, we are those who are made alive in Christ. Don't let the gravity of this message get lost on you today. If we are in him and he is in us, then what can we not do? Is there any mountain that's unclimbable if he says to climb it? Is there any obstacle that's unmovable if he says to move? Are any circumstances too big? Anything that becomes too much for him and us and us and him? I think not. Jesus is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Anything that comes, he already knows about it before it happens. Anything that happens, he is before it. Anything that changes in our life, he is there. Who are we that we should worry about tomorrow? Jesus is sufficient for us today. My hope for us is to solidify the hope that we have in Christ. That no matter what comes, no matter what troubles or hardships we face, we have nothing to worry about because Jesus is sufficient for us. We could be sitting in internment camps together. Jesus is sufficient for us. He could take away everything we own. Jesus is sufficient for us. He can send us to deep, dark places to shine the light. Jesus is sufficient for us. This is what Vanessa was talking about earlier, Matthew 6:31. So do not worry, saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Jesus is in control. We have the hope of glory today. Amen. His stamp and his work is clearly evident in us and around us today. So even when these things come, he gives us strength to carry on. He provides for our needs. The hope of glory is Christ in us. We have to go back to the Word of God, which is filled with the power of God, which pours out the knowledge of God, about the person of God, for the glory of God, to the people of God. One of the most dangerous things that we can do right now is to neglect our relationship with Jesus. Vanessa said it earlier. There are literally thousands of voices, powers that are fighting for our minds, trying to convince you what to think. But we can be certain we are being shaped and conditioned in this time. We need more scripture and less social media. We need more Jesus and less conspiracy, more prayer, less news, more of him, and really, less of everything else. That spirit which sought to add Jesus plus something else is still alive in our culture today. This message of Christ is as powerful today as it was to the church in Colossae. So let me close with this. Charles Spurgeon, the great prince of preachers, He once said this, speaking about God's glory. He said, glory? Surely that belongs to God alone. To him alone be glory, yes. But Christ has said, Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, and that they may behold my glory. And he also says, and the glory which thou hast given me, I have given them. It's the hope of glory in us. Think of it, glory for us poor creatures. Glory for you, sister. Glory for you, my brother. Glory for me. It seems a strange thing that a sinner should ever have anything to do with glory when he deserves nothing but shame. We are neither kings nor princes. What have we to do with glory? Yet glory is to be our dwelling. Glory, our light. Glory, our crown. Glory, our song. The Lord will not be content to give us less than his glory. Grace is very sweet. Might we not be content to swim forever in a sea of grace, but no, the Lord will give grace and glory. You see, to us as the people of God, grace has been given. To us, the hope of glory has been revealed. In him, we have all that we need today. The glory is that anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. The glory is that no matter the sin, his grace is sufficient to cover us in all our faults, in all our failures. If you haven't given your life to Jesus, don't let this moment pass. Surrender your life to him by offering up a simple prayer. Romans 10:9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. It's at that moment conversion happens. It's at that moment you step from death into life, from darkness into light, and he writes your name forever in the Lamb's book of life. Who doesn't want that glory and that hope? If that's you and you've never received Jesus, you've never prayed to ask Jesus into your heart, don't leave this place without talking to one of us. We want to help you. We want to lead you in that prayer today. Okay? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, God, we thank you for your glory that you bestow upon us, those who are so undeserving. Just enough. Grace is enough. But yet you call us to live in glory. Jesus, may we remember your words today as we go. That we know that we're not just carrying around this sack of flesh, but it is you in us. Down to the molecular level, God, you hold us together by the cross of your Son. Help us to not forget the things that you are. Help us to walk not in powerlessness, but in great power. Not as victims, but as victors. Because you are our King. You are our Father. We worship you this morning.